In a world filled with war, hate, suffering, and Justin Bieber, two guys fix it all with a battle about a movie. One film, two opinions, one coin, two sides. They feud. You decide. It's time for Film Feud.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Film Feud, the podcast where we debate whether top-rated movies should be top-rated. I'm Vidur.
And I'm Vikram.
Vikram, just in case someone's listening for the first time, mind explaining what we do here?
What we do is we select a movie from the IMDb top 250 randomly, and we toss the coin.
The Film Feud coin.
Oh, jinx. 1, 2, 3. And heads argues for the movie and tails argues against.
And this week, we are about to feud over Christopher Nolan's The Prestige.
Interesting.
So both of us are Nolan fans. And we've both seen this movie probably more than once already.
Yeah, I've seen it a couple of times, for sure.
I've seen it a couple of times as well. Not in a while, though. So I'm excited to see it again.
Yeah, man. I think I saw this movie in college last. It's been about 5-6 years at least.
Now it just feels like Batman versus Wolverine, basically.
Yeah, our last movie was a Hugh Jackman movie as well.
That's true. Logan. Hashtag Logan.
Way to drop in the hashtag there, brother.
All right. So why don't we just get to the coin toss then?
Yeah, let's do it.
I'm going to be tossing the coin. Heads is for and tails is against. And it's heads.
Thank God, man. This is like Nolan's worst movie ever.
Oh, really?
Yeah, dude. This is the movie that's holding me back.
Wait.
Okay.
Just stop. Don't even pretend. Save it for after we've seen the movie. Let's see what you actually come up with.
No, very seriously, this is the movie that holds me back from being the ultimate super f***ing Nolan fanboy.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Insomnia, on the other hand, it kept you up at night. It was so good.
Dude, have you seen Insomnia?
Wait a second. First, acknowledge my joke.
Good one, yaar. Have you seen Insomnia, though? Al Pacino kills it. He literally kills it.
I have not seen Insomnia.
It's a great movie. I don't even know why it's not on the top 250. It might be Nolan's best movie yet.
So your strategy so far on receiving tails,
you don't know my strategy, bro.
Has been to hype up Insomnia.
My strategy is going to be plain truth.
I see.
As usual.
I see. Ready to get to it?
Yeah, let's do it, man. Let's go watch the movie.
Let's do it.
So that was a good movie, man. The Illusionist. Ed Norton's pretty good, man. Isn't that what we were watching?
Yes, The Illusionist and The Prestige came out at the same time. Both movies about stage magicians in the Victorian era.
It's literally like White House Down and Olympus Has Fallen.
Yeah, or Deep Impact and Armageddon. Like two movies about the same thing in 2006. Yeah.
I think The Illusionist did it better, obviously. No points in saying that.
How much more predictable could your did it better have been than saying The Illusionist did it better, please?
Okay, since we're talking about that...
What do you mean, since we're talking about that? You brought it up. You started off our discussion about The Prestige by talking about it.
Just adding to your point about how predictable my did it better was, I think Judwa did it better. I mean, Salman Khan killed it, dude. These guys couldn't even do it properly.
Yeah, I'm just imagining Salman Khan playing the role of Borden now, basically. How come there's never been a Bollywood version of this, man?
Because it won't work, and for the right reasons. This is so confusing. It makes no sense.
All right, just let me know when you're done.
I'm done with the did it better part. I was thinking of throwing duplicate into this, but I was like, Judwa's good enough.
Oh,
this movie is
God.
Literally The Illusionist plus Judwa is equal to Prestige.
This movie is literally The Illusionist plus Judwa.
Yeah, literally.
Literally.
Being very specific about literally.
Have you said your piece?
About the did it better? I mean, I could throw some more into that, but yeah, I'm good for right now.
This movie was amazing. Amazing. It's a solid contestant for best Nolan movie ever. Because it's not like Inception, like mind-blowing. It's not like super gimmicky like Memento or anything like that. it's just an amazing story. And the whole movie is like, the magic trick is the movie, and the movie is the magic trick, the symbolism. The movie has a pledge, the movie has a turn, then the movie has a prestige. So meta-cinematic, meta-magical, cinematic, magical. You get my point.
I do.
Amazing.
To your point, the third act here, which is the prestige part of the movie, it doesn't hold up to the first two at all.
The prestige of the prestige?
Yeah, the prestige of the prestige doesn't hold up to the turn and the whatever other f***.
Why, in what way? You think the twist is not cool? The first time I watched it, I distinctly remember not having guessed the twist. Did you?
The Christian Bale twist?
The Christian Bale twist.
I don't remember, honestly, the first time. But the second time, because I knew it, maybe it came into play there. But I feel like if a more mature... If I would view it right now, for example, for the first time ever, I would definitely know that something's up with Fallon and Borden and all that stuff. For sure.
If you knew it was a Nolan movie, yeah, you'd probably be thinking or whatever. But
even if it's not a Nolan movie, dude, like...
Okay, just because you've seen more movies, perhaps. I see what you're saying, but... I definitely didn't know the first time and my mind was kind of blown. I don't exactly remember, but I'm pretty sure that's the case. And then when you watch it the second time, it actually adds a lot to the viewing experience. Because for one thing, Christian Bale is actually playing two different characters. And you don't realize that until you actually know the twist and go back and watch it. That was pretty cool. And then the foreshadowing is like God-level foreshadowing. I mean...
God-level.
Yeah, literally everything like that's revealed is, of course, foreshadowed. But then... Also, it's always so meta. Everything has like double meanings. Everything is like reflected in their past selves. Like if they have a belief that shows up early in the movie, then you know it's going to be either subverted or played into. I mean, it's just an amazing piece of filmmaking, man. Just like technically, even if you take the actual like acting and music and all that stuff out of it, just the way he's told the story, the way he's put the flashbacks and the character relationship he's built over the course of, I think they show like 20 years or something, is just amazing.
Yeah. So to your point about Christian Bale playing two different characters and having that whole, you know, living half a life of a full life, whatever, just so that I can get my few positives from the movie out of the way, I really like Christian Bale's acting in this movie. It was actually really, really tremendous. And he actually, once you rewatch it, you sort of understand how he was... Borden at one point in time, he was Fallon in the other, and you sort of get that.
Boom.
But that's it.
Point to me. That Christian Bale is amazing and everything. I mean, let's face it, especially during this phase.
I mean, there was this Terminator movie out in the middle.
Salvation. Yeah, okay, he wasn't amazing in that at all. Yeah. He was still like Christian Bale in it. Also, thanks to him being in that movie, you got that epic rant.
Yeah. which Family Guy actually killed.
Yeah.
Yeah. But to that, I mean, all the other actors, we'll talk about it as we go on. Hugh Jackman just feels like he's just going to bust out into a musical or some shit. Or
just because he's Hugh Jackman. Just because you know he does
Hugh
musicals.
Hugh Jackman should stick to musicals or Wolverine. And he's done that for a reason. And he's been hugely successful because he can't act like a normal actor.
What are you saying? He was great.
He was horrible. And especially the scenes with him and Scarlett Johansson. Again, very big disappointment in this movie, dude.
Scarlett Johansson's like one of the key points I have for this movie. She's so hot in this movie.
So hot or her acting?
So hot. Who cares about acting? She barely needs to act. She has like some fake ass dumb accent. Who cares?
Dude, it's horrible. And that scene with her and Hugh Jackman when they're alone. Oh my God. I literally wanted to pause and or skip that scene. But
how can you even think of skipping that scene? That scene is like a tribute to push-up bras everywhere in the world.
Wow. I mean, you're not watching a porno here, bro. You're watching the prestige. So let's just like...
How? Dude, that's all she's doing. She has like the word, like the don't ask me how I know this. Inside information.
Before you tell me what it is, how do you know it?
TMZ? I don't know. This was before she got her breast reduction. And
oh, she got
shows.
A breast reduction?
Bro, do you not keep up with TMZ?
No, man.
She had like some serious like magician assistant like look going on, chest-wise.
I mean, dude, if that's the only reason she's in the movie, give her no dialogues then. You're ruining it. Literally, you're ruining it.
No, it's not ruining it. She had like
she's
a small
really,
role.
Really
she
bad.
Was a Woody Allen muse at this time. She could do that kind of acting. She tried. She put on a dumb accent.
She tried and
best.
It fell flat. So
okay,
flat.
So it fell
and
flat.
That scene with her and Hugh Jackman, the two worst actors in the movie with substantial roles, that scene was so bad.
Okay, so it was one scene. I don't think it was that bad. I noticed an accent changing in that scene. You granted me the Christian Bale acting. I'll grant you the lack of Scarlett Johansson acting a little bit.
I mean, and Jackman too. Come on, you can't defend his acting.
Jackman is okay. His acting was well beyond serviceable.
well beyond serviceable is not a term that can be used for actors in a Nolan movie, ever.
I think Alfred, what's his face? What's his name?
Michael Caine.
I think Michael
Caine. Sir Michael Caine.
Sir Michael Caine's acting was also at the same level, well beyond serviceable.
See, I think the whole Michael Caine-Nolan love affair needs to tone down a little bit. Like every movie starting with Michael Caine's narration, ending with Michael Caine's narration, Michael Caine being not Michael Caine.
Dunkirk didn't do it.
That is why Dunkirk is actually...
Because there's no Michael Caine. That's why Dunkirk is awesome. I thought this was the least Zabardasti Michael Caine, or one of the least Zabardasti Michael Caines in any Nolan movie.
Most has to be Rises, right?
Dark Knight Rises.
Yeah.
Well, no, I mean, he's Alfred, so he's going to be in the movie. The most Zabardasti is like Inception, where he plays like his dad, is it?
Yeah.
Or...
But he's barely there in Inception. It doesn't really count.
Interstellar, where he plays a professor for like no reason. But then he's there to like recite poetry, which is fine, I guess.
Yeah, I feel like he has to be there. But by Zabardasti, I mean like him just being like overacting.
No, but
like
here he has a real character that makes a real difference. He's like the Piyush Mishra character in the Gangs of Wazipur movies.
Oh, Gangs? Remember that movie a little bit.
Yeah, he's basically like the consigliere slash, what do they call it? Ingenieur.
Ingenieur.
I don't know, that's where the word engineer comes from. That's awesome. Did you know both of us were ingenieurs?
Yeah, or ingenieur, as like Desi people like to call it. Ingenieur?
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 There's a certain French twang.
Ingenieur.
Dude, there's something for everyone in this movie.
Oh yeah? What is there for midgets?
Scarlett Johansson.
Okay. I feel like that'll be your answer for like 90% of my questions.
Yeah.
Something specific for the other 10%.
For men, there's Scarlett Johansson.
Right.
For women... Mm-hmm. There's Hugh Jackman and Christian Bale. This is basically like girl porn.
Oh, it is. Do girls find Christian Bale hot?
I find Christian Bale hot. Forget girls.
Really?
Yeah, he was the Dark Knight. What are you talking about? This is like what the man from Uncle was trying to do. Just be like legitimize girl porn by having like Superman with Army Hammer. This is like the Batman version of that. Yeah, like instead of having Superman, have Batman. Whatever, stupid point. So they have that for guys. Uh-huh. They have that for girls.
Uh-huh. That's it. Aur bache nahi yaar koi.
And for magicians, they have magic stuff.
So this movie's technically, from an artsy point of view, it's for magicians.
Yeah.
For the general folk, it's just like
core audience versus broad audience.
Okay. I get it. I feel like you're arguing for me right now.
No, my point is, man, like it just incorporates such good storytelling from so many different perspectives. So you get the whole rivalry thing, you know, which is almost like a Western concept. There's plenty of movies that you can get that with. They combine the magician thing and they become like deep character studies. Especially the reveal adds so much insight to all the characters, whether it's the Christian Bale reveal or whether it's like all the reveals about like Angiers' plan and Borden's plan, like when they give each other's diary and they're both fake outs. That just tells the watcher more about the character and it ends up becoming this weird character study. When Christian Bale's character is like actually just this crazy ass artist, right? He's like a guy who takes this performance art to the next level. So he's basically like psychotic with his art. And that makes you actually think about the guy afterwards. Like when you find out at the end, that's what the whole movie was about. Aren't you thinking like how did he live his life and shit?
Yeah, few points for that. Why would he do that? Makes no sense. I understand they try to foreshadow that with the whole Chinese magician and the goldfish trick.
Gold. Yeah, he talks about it with his wife that his greatest trick ever is going to happen. He's been keeping his twin brother in his back pocket, knowing this whole time that that's going to be his greatest trick ever. I saw this YouTube video and the main takeaway from The Prestige was Nolan's ability to hide in plain sight, which is to say that he keeps saying that he uses a double, which is what a twin is. He uses a double, he uses a twin. And in the end, he actually does use the twin. And just like a magic trick, it's actually more fascinating, the trick itself. And once you find out the secret, it's kind of underwhelming.
Why doesn't Borden just tell Sarah, his wife, about the whole twin situation here, man? I mean, it's such a pain that he has to undergo, which results in her just killing herself. I understand, you know, the whole nature of sticking to your craft or whatnot based on the Chinese magician, but this is fucking stupid.
Listen, man, like, you can't just put some things under the microscope and let other things go. He was an artist through and through. This was his life. This was number one to him. And Sarah and even his daughter, or at least like a typical normative life for them was number two to the magic. That was the difference between Angier and Borden. Like, the sacrifice he was constantly willing to make. That was such a big theme of the movie, too, is the sacrifice. And supposedly, by the end of it, Angier makes it, too. But Borden is just making it throughout. And, you know, they foreshadow it with the Chinese guy. And it just plays out perfectly here. They both live half of a full life.
Stop it. Stop it. Stop quoting the movie. And firstly, he has a fucking twin brother who no one knows about. Literally no one who just appears in the middle of a movie. All of a sudden, Fallon's there. Have you noticed that Fallon's not there in like the first act?
It's
literally?
Not all of a sudden. I mean, as soon as his wife, Angiers' wife dies.
No.
When they go solo, that's when Fallon appears. Because
No. When they go solo, he meets Sarah. They do their shit or whatever. And when they're actually steady and Sarah's like expecting a kid is when that's Fallon's first scene, if you think about it.
Okay.
Where was he before this? Where was his ingenieur?
He was just a stagehand or whatever at the time. So Fallon wasn't in the picture. He didn't need to be. They would just take turns being, I guess they like traded notes every day or what happened in their day.
And like brain dumped like their entire day to each other.
It is kind of confusing to think about what happened.
I read this one review where they call Fallon his butler. That was hilarious.
His butler. See, one thing I respect is that at least they made the most of themselves being twins. I think twins is like such a weird ass thing that to be a twin and to not be into pranks is just like a waste of life.
But this is way too elaborate, man.
This is the extreme, but I'd rather have the extreme than twins who just pretend like
you're completely fine with sleeping with your twin brother's wife at times and sleeping with your assistant at times. You're just like, you're completely one person.
Yeah.
It's so messed up.
Yeah, it's messed
up. It's a brain
yeah.
fart, dude. I don't get it, man. And just speaking about this part a little bit, there was this alternative fan theory that I read on Reddit, which would have made this movie so much sicker. It's unbelievable.
Okay.
So it's basically, you know how they keep mentioning that Tesla made a machine for another magician? So just assuming that it was Borden, right?
Yeah, which was really confusing. Like, was it Borden? Or...
Yeah, it made no sense. It was just like thrown in there for the fuck of it, right? But imagine if it was actually Borden, and imagine if Tesla had made the exact same machine for Borden. And Borden ended up cloning himself once, but destroyed the machine because Tesla keeps saying you destroy the machine, right? So uh-huh. He cloned himself once, destroyed
the
machine.
And Fallon is a clone.
And Fallon is the clone. And they're just like playing it from there. And how Hugh Jackman ends up like, losing it and like just like overusing the machine and just going crazy and stuff.
So I like that fan theory a lot. In fact, I haven't had a chance to properly think about it, but
let me just wrap up the fan theory there, because that's beyond this is where it gets a little ludicrous. It states that Cutter, i.e. Michael Caine, was the main dude of the movie. So he got Borden on board because he really respected him as a magician, sent Borden to Tesla gave Borden being Bale the machine. Bale clones himself, destroys the machine. And then the whole...
Wait a second.
Yeah.
Wait a second.
Yeah.
So Cutter just has like Tesla in his back pocket.
Yeah, the guy who can create... Yeah, they're homies. Like he knows that Tesla's around and stuff. And like essentially the end part is that once Jackman loses it and starts cloning and killing himself over and over again, Cutter just realizes that, oh, he's lost his shit. So that's when he gets Borden back and he's like, okay, let's go kill this guy.
That devolved pretty quickly.
Yeah, I know, right?
I do like the fact that it would explain why Fallon wasn't there
part
in the beginning.
Movie, yeah.
No, it's a cool theory. And that actually brings me to the part which I thought you'd bring up first is, oh, like, why doesn't Angiers just copy himself only once instead of like killing his own clone every time?
Yeah, that's a good question. I have one personal opinion there and one opinion that I read.
Great, do my job for me. Let's hear
it. The personal opinion is that he's more tilted, if that's the correct word, than Christian Bale is during the entire movie, and he's like more
obsessive,
vengeful and all of that. So maybe that part of his personality plays out and he keeps killing it. And the thing that I read on the internet, which kind of makes sense, is because to fit in with the script of the movie and the narrative there, he will never be able to frame Bale for the murder then, right? If he just clones himself once and...
So the reason he's killing himself every night is so that he can...
That's what I read on the internet. That's what the closest thing I could find was to fit in there. And they don't explain that at all. The whole court scene and the whole judge going to the theater to see the equipment and shit. What the fuck was that, dude? What the fuck was that? He's standing there. This one magistrate actually, he actually questions, how do you expect him to push that fucking 1,000-liter tank below the stage? And all Michael Caine says is, he's a magician, go figure it. And that's it. They go check out the machine, a machine which supposedly clones people. Which
and Cutter just says, oops, magic.
Yeah, Cutter says, this is not magic, this is real. And the guy just turns around, he's like, oh, is that the tank? And they just start talking about the water tank. That's a fucking judge not giving a fuck about a machine that clones people.
It's like set in a world where there's magical realism. Hashtag Salman Rushdie. And the court case also unexplained. You only see a glimpse of it. It's fine. I mean,
it's the first scene, by the way.
It's the first scene, but surely, even though you think probabilistically Christian Bale should not have gone to jail, surely you can see a path where he might have. And that's all that matters, right? This is like a very Nolan thing. Leave it ambiguous. You can think what you want with it. As long as you can see a path, that's good enough.
I guess, man. I mean, let's move forward. I have another few extremely detailed gripes that I want to touch upon. Uh-huh. This being a Nolan film, I'm like coursing through it with a very zoomed in lens. Does that make sense?
Yeah. nice little filmmaking analogy there too.
Yeah. I mean, so one thing. Okay, Tesla's shown to be a badass, obviously.
Tesla, David Bowie, rest in peace.
Clones people. In 1899. So he's super
fucking... Science is magnificent, man. Magical realism. Yeah. Hashtag Salman Rushdie.
No one's been able to come close. We're fucking barely cloning Dolly the sheep. And this motherfucker is cloning fuckers using alternating current or whatever the fuck that is, right?
Nobody's come close to interstellar travel. I don't hear you complaining.
Who did that in 1899?
My point is...
Oh, the movie. Oh, okay. I get it.
Nobody's come close to like dream whatever the fuck they do in Inception.
But like, they don't show like a real person doing that in the movie. Tesla.
Who cares?
Tesla was a guy. You know that, right?
Tesla was a dude. Yeah, he's a cool dude. Yeah.
Cool guy. Hated, but he was good. So, Tesla being the smart ass he is and his mundu running around like knowing all of that shit.
Wait a second. Did you just call Andy Serkis, the great Andy Serkis, his mundu?
He's the mundu with a shotgun.
That was such a great cameo, man.
And Bowie in itself was interesting as well.
It's a cool take on Tesla. Like, I don't know what Tesla was actually like. To me, Tesla is Tesla, the car company now. And of course, I mean, I know that who Nikola Tesla was, but now I'll always imagine Bowie every time I think of Tesla.
I felt like they should have gone with a stronger European accent.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, I don't think he did a too good a job. It doesn't matter. When I was watching it, I was like, okay, Tesla now clones people. It's like, man, the car company is really going in the wrong direction. Like, they should aim a little higher.
What an engineer you are, huh?
Yeah.
Anyway, so my point here is, these f***ers, they're running the show from atop of a mountain, doing their experiments, providing an entire city with electricity and stuff. They didn't know they had 12 big-ass black hats in their backyard. Till And Hugh Jackman, of all people, told them. And they're all like, oh, what is this?
You're really nitpicking here.
Why shouldn't I? That's the intro of the movie. That scene like has such a significance on the events and all of
it's
that.
It's the leitmotif.
Why did they... And apparently because they're guarding it so secretly, so obviously Mundu would know what's around and what's not.
It's just the two of them. Stop calling Andy Serkis Mundu. If you want, you shall call him either Smeagol or Caesar.
Mundu. Shotgun Mundu is my term for him. Oh, Mundu's running around the fucking campus, like fucking monitoring shit, like making sure no one's like breaking in, like they have electrical fences. They have hats the size of my fucking face just lying around in their backyard and they don't even notice.
It's not a backyard, it's a mountain. Who knows where in the mountain it was.
Dude, did you see Hugh Jackman walking down towards the entrance? Just take a right and it's right there. All of that shit's right there.
All right, let's move on from your stupid ass point.
Mundu can't even do his job properly, man.
Yeah. Oh my god, you're so desperate here. I understand it's an amazing Nolan masterpiece and you're forced to argue against it.
Can we not get in the movie, man? What the shit?
Yeah,
dude.
He cloned.
Really?
So is it science? Is it magic? Is it wizardry?
It's science. He's fucking Nikola Tesla. It's fucking science, dude.
So it's science. Science.
And like
don't
his
understand.
Mundu, who's been around like such genius apparently for so long in the movie, right? He's still fascinated by how the great Danton can guess what people have in their pocket. What the fuck?
Yeah, so you think scientists...
He sees cats being cloned, currents running here and there, like Tesla doing his shit. I say, hey, what am I holding in my pocket? kiya mundu.
Again, it's all very good commentary on the nature of magic. Magic is awesome. Call me a geek, nerd, loser. I love magic. And science is like way cooler. But you don't think scientists find it cool when you take like a quarter out of their ear or something like that? It's awesome.
100% they don't. They probably scoff at you.
Come on,
they're like,
dude.
Oh, you can move your hands really well. Good. Good job.
Scientists are not bored at magic shows. I promise you that. That's what you're hypothesizing.
I'm pretty sure they're yawning. Scientists, hardcore scientists like Tesla, will give two shits about a magic show happening in there.
So Tesla's not that impressed. His little Mundu assistant, is. Mundu is, yeah.
Yes.
I'm on the Mundu train now. Yeah, Tesla is dismissive. He's like, oh yeah, my partner, my whatever, he can't stop like raving about your show. And he doesn't give a f-.
I mean, I don't know, bro.
Let's just move on to the bigger, broader themes of the movie.
Yeah.
Like sacrifice, rivalry, jealousy.
Yawn.
Oh my God, so great. I read the greatest joke about this movie, actually.
Uh-huh.
It was actually a YouTube comment.
What's it?
You know, the end of the movie when Borden's shot Angiers in the stomach. It's kind of lame because then Angiers, like a Bollywood hero, is getting to say exactly
dialogue,
what he wants.
Full on dialogue happening.
Yeah, until he dies. Yeah. And then he like reveals everything he needs to reveal. But anyway, then Borden.
What's that, dude? It's like full on like superhero, like villain tells the whole plot about his plans and then dies. Nolan, bro.
So then Borden goes, you never understood it takes sacrifice or something like that. And then Jackman goes like, I've made sacrifice. You remember that?
Yeah.
And so the greatest comment I saw was it said, Jackman, I've made sacrifices. I was an X-Men Origins Wolverine.
Yeah. That part was stupid, dude. Like, he could have done it better, Nolan. Figured out a way for Jackman to really reveal everything to Borden in not a
the whole shot in the stomach thing was kind of stupid.
How are you? What are you? And then it just like
and then full speech.
Full on 5 minute scene of like them exchanging dialogues and shit. That's stupid as shit, dude.
What I found stupid about that scene, and this is probably one of the only nitpicks I would make myself about the movie.
This is probably the sixth nitpick you're making.
Go fuck yourself. Alright, forget it. The only nitpick would be that what was Angiers' plan anyway? I mean, didn't he think Fallon would f***ing come after him?
I know, right?
Because Fallon came after him and shot him in the stomach.
I was going to raise this
How
point.
Was he not protected against that scenario occurring?
He just like forgets about him. Even though like he obviously doesn't know that Fallon's a twin, but still he's so close
he should be wary of Fallon. I think like his security was only against people who don't look like Christian Bale because Christian Bale was dead.
I mean, there's only, apparently in his eyes, there's only one dude who looks like Christian Bale.
That's why. As long as the person looked like Christian
Bale, completely
forgot
about Fallon. Obviously, no repercussions. I'm a lord.
Wait, which guy died though in the end? Was it... Who was Borden? Who was Fallon? Borden was the guy
I'm calling Borden the original and Fallon...
Who was the original though?
The guy who's... up until Fallon appears in the movie... The guy who's Christian Bale.
But how do we know that it's not a combination of the two?
Because, dude, like,
because isn't
you can
that
tell.
The confusion between, like, who tied the knot? The fact that he tied the knot, he says that it's, I don't know, is that a Borden Fallon thing?
Could be, I guess. That doesn't make any sense.
I'm
totally feeling the whole Nikola Tesla theory here, where Fallon is the clone.
Fallon is the clone. Okay, even if Fallon is a clone, which one of them died?
Clone.
The clone died?
Yeah. See, I'll tell you why. Bale.
But the original is the guy who's married.
Original is the guy who's married to Sarah. Clone is the guy who's in love with Scarlett Johansson.
And how do we know that? They act different. They act different.
You can, like, I feel like the clone is slightly off. He's a little more vengeful. He's more like Angier. And the original Bale is more compassionate. He's more like forgiving. So he's the one who's all like, oh, let's not pursue Angier anymore. And that's why if in the last scene when Bale is talking to Fallon when he's about to like get hanged, he's walking away and he's saying, I'm sorry, I should have listened to you. I shouldn't have pursued him.
I shouldn't have gone, yeah.
Yeah,
so
and then he also apologizes for Sarah. He says, I'm sorry about Sarah. So it's obvious that Fallon is the original. Yeah, so the clone is the guy who dies. I like how you're calling him clone full on now.
Sorry, yeah. So Fallon dies.
Fallon dies.
But that's not that meaningful. Fallon didn't even have the rivalry.
Fallon is actually the guy who felt the rivalry more than Borden, the original guy.
Why?
Fallon's the guy who's slightly tilted. He's the guy who's all like, why can't you figure this out? Why can't you be smarter than him?
Oh.
When they're sitting, when him and Sarah, when they start showing Sarah slipping, And then they're having dinner and he's acting like really cocky and like all like famous and stuff. And he's drinking and celebrating. You know that that's the clone. And then whenever he says,
but
I love you to Sarah.
Which one of them had their fingers blown off by?
The original.
How do you know?
Because the entire interaction with Sarah prior to when he shows her the trick as well, right? It's him. It's the original guy because
right.
they had that scene where he says, I love you, and she believes him and shit like that as well.
Oh, right. So
every time
you.
She believes him, it's the original. It's every the original. Time she doesn't, it's Fallon.
Right.
Clone, bro. Speaking of clones and like twins and shit, Hugh Jackman's body double is getting shit-faced sitting in a bar when the great Danton is like superior and he's famous, like London's best, whatever. He's getting shit-faced in a bar and no one recognizes him. He looks exactly the same as Hugh Jackman.
I'm surprised that's your issue as opposed to the whole body double part of the screenplay where they go and find a body double
who's
and
exactly
it turns out to be
same.
So exactly looking that it's Hugh Jackman. Because then it's so weird because that takes you out of the movie, right? Then it makes you feel like,
yeah.
Oh, this is the movie.
It literally became Jodhwa at that point, dude. Think about it. The way the makeup and like the attire that Lord Caldway or whatever Angiers is at the end, you give him like a grayish, greenish hue with his hair and stuff and that's the body double. Just getting
right.
shit-faced. And he's sitting in a bar all the time getting shit-faced and no one recognizes him at the Great Danton. You make just like shave his face or whatever and all of a sudden on stage he looks exactly the same. That was kind of stupid. Like they could have made more of an effort in terms of makeup and get up for the body double to make him slightly different. And even when they don't, even when they make him look exactly like Hugh Jackman, when Cutter like cleans him up and stuff, even then, like he has free reign to go to any bar and get shit-faced.
They keep saying they kept him under wraps.
Well, that whole scene when Borden actually confronts him and like incepts him with that idea of like whatever, that part is like him just being exactly the same in terms of get up to Hugh Jackman.
Yeah, he looks exactly the same in that scene for some reason.
That's so retarded. Like how, I'm actually disappointed with Nolan to like just let these small things go because they add
magical
up, man,
realism,
end,
bro. Magical
you
realism.
You can't just keep saying that for like. For like covering up like mistakes he made because these small things add up and then they have a perception by the end of it and especially when you rewatch the movie it actually it maybe like the wow factor and the awe factor in the first viewing is there but like the second viewing it completely goes away.
The second viewing or whatever viewing this was for me actually had me doubling up on the wow factor because you see all the clues, you see the whole hiding in plain sight, dude. You see what he's left for you. And then you realize he's tricked you. He's just like a magician. He hid everything in plain sight. You had everything you needed. But he just kept misdirecting. There are red herrings in the movie that end up being red herrings for us. Which is, for instance, Tesla is a red herring for Angiers. But then he ends up actually making the real thing. Then you like confused because it actually works or not. The movie's such a mind f**k. And then it slowly, you understand the tone, you understand the universe of the movie completely by the end, and that's when the twist comes, that's when the prestige of the movie comes. Oh, amazing, man. Amazing.
I don't know. I don't feel it too much. I kind of wish I hadn't seen the movie again, because whatever I had in my head about the prestige, I kind of wanted to be there, because I actually truly like Nolan, but the goof-ups in this movie and the things he just let slip, I mean, they really added up, and I didn't feel it by the end of it.
I just thought it was just Nolan knocking it out of the park again, man. You know, he played with like the editing. The cinematography is just mind-blowing. I mean, this guy who he worked with, Wally Pfister, I think it started here, or maybe Batman Begins, but they've been a team ever since. And I think it's just the movie is visually very stunning. And the editing, he plays with time as he is now very well known to do. But you know, he's intercutting between different times, people reading diaries, and yet you just follow along perfectly. Like, he starts at the ending, like the flashback in the beginning, for instance, is actually the last scene of the movie. They're constantly intercutting between present day, his previous story. He just makes it work so well. And for once, a relatively clear-cut, understandable ending. Oh my God. What a relief. What a pleasure.
Yeah, that was very unlike Nolan, though. I mean, apart from like Dunkirk or some shit, but one of his most straightforward endings for sure, which, I don't know, he kind of went overkill with the whole
ambiguous ending.
Yeah, and also like the whole like ambiguous nature of the whole third act, right? Just the whole
right.
double crossing, triple crossing and all that. So I guess a straightforward ending made sense, but he could have done it better, dude, 100%.
So this brings me to an obvious question. If you don't think this movie deserves to be in the IMDb top 250, which, what a thought. What movie...
Do I even need to say it?
Would you want to replace this with?
You mean apart from The Illusionist?
Yes. Let's not even get into The Illusionist. It's an inferior movie.
And Jurva?
And Jurva is definitely an inferior... Let's not even mutter Jurva and anything by Nolan in the same breath.
To replace this movie in the IMDb 250, I would actually like to replace this with another Nolan movie, one of my favorite Nolan movies. Top two, actually.
There's only one that's not in the IMDb top 250.
And it thoroughly deserves to be. This one does not, and Insomnia does. What a great movie. How can it not be in the top 250?
I haven't even seen it. I've seen like chunks of it. It's like a very like catch it on TV movie, is it not?
No, is it? It's a fucking go online and watch it movie and get your mind blown away movie.
All right, I can't even defend it because I haven't seen the movie.
It's a Nolan movie. No way. You know it. It's fucking brilliant.
I agree. Yeah, by that logic.
Except for the prestige.
All right, I would like to end this by us performing the scene of the movie where Borden is getting hanged.
You mean clone?
Yes, you're right. Fallon, clone, is getting hanged. And I guess the jailer says, do you have anything to say?
And then the clone says, abracadabra, gilly gilly goosh.
What? I don't know about the gilly gilly goosh part, but... So now you're going to play the jailer, and I'm going to play Christian Bale.
Okay.
All right.
Do you have anything to say?
I'm Batman.
So guys, that was this week's episode of Film Feud.
Thanks for tuning in. Now, we feuded, you get to decide. Tweet at us at Film Feud Pod. Let us know who you think won. Let us know what arguments you might have made. I'm pretty sure I'm going to win this one, Vikram.
Bro, you always lose. What's the point?
All right, so it's time to figure out what movie we're going to feud about next week.
Yeah, let's spin that wheel.
Yeah, let's spin the Film Feud wheel. What'd we get?
Thakur.
Did we get Shole?
We got f***ing Shole, dude. Number 228, Shole.
Oh my god. It's time for a Bollywood classic.
Wait. Just to clarify, have you seen Shole?
Of course I've seen Shole. Everybody's seen Shole. Shole is just a cultural milestone. Like, I remember every big scene there is to remember from Shole. I remember that stupid song. Not stupid, it's a nice song.
Which
one? Depends on the coin toss. No, Mehbooba is actually awesome. I meant,
that's from Shole.
Yeah.
Oh, Viru and all that shit. The only thing that comes to my mind from Shole is like Gabbar, obviously.
Yeah, and Asrani.
Basanti. Asrani? Asrani.
Aadhe. Udhar ki taraf. Aadhe.
You seem to love this one, huh?
Idhar ki taraf. Or Baki. No, it's Shole. Not about love, man. It's Shole. Everybody knows Shole.
No, I'd forgotten a lot of it, but yeah, it's coming back to me.
So, this is going to be a second Bollywood movie.
Yes, this is.
After Gangs of Wazipur. And this actually is super Bollywood. It's not like international film festival the way Gangs
was.
It's
as Bollywood as it gets, man. Yeah.
This is like classic Bollywood. So, that's a kind of a warning, I suppose, to our listeners, or an invitation, depends on how you want to look at it, that the next episode is going to be Bollywood.
So yeah, guys, we're going to be doing Shole next week.
That's right. Make sure you tune in next week. Until then, don't forget to subscribe on iTunes, Stitcher, or wherever you listen to podcasts.
Bye.
See ya.